When I came back from the conference, I was moved that much that I wrote to the Prime Minister and I wrote to Phillip because he sat in the budget, obviously, in the end of this month, I think it is. But I haven't had a reply from them. But I also wrote to Lord Porter, who's the chair of the LGA, and he has written back to me. And I'm not going to read the whole letter, but I'm just going to read one of the paragraphs. It says, at the National Children's Mental Service Conference earlier this month, we launched the Bright Futures campaign, which calls on the government to properly fund children's services. We're asking the government to close the $2 billion funding gap in children's services, reverse the cuts to early intervention funding, and develop some of the Departmental for Education improvements funding for local councils. So, children's services have been squeezed in all areas, from early intervention, from before a child is born, the services have been cut, the schools have been cut, we've been cut. So that everything that you need to support and bring the future of not just the Wirral, the future of this country, the children, all of that has been squeezed. And I know people say children are massacres, they can't vote. And I would hate to think that that would be some of the motivation behind some of this, but it has got to stop. And it's putting such a strain on this council and three out of four councils in the country. It's putting such a strain on it that every other person is suffering, all the other services are suffering because of it. As I say, I've written to the Prime Minister and to Phillip Hammond, and we have, and I've also written to the education secretaries. And she wrote back a letter saying, well, we're doing this, we're doing that, we're doing the other. So I sent her down another letter saying, yes, we are doing all of them, but even if we tap into all that little bit of funding that here on the Wirral, we're still £1 million short for what we do with our schools. Everywhere you go, they're taking money off the most vulnerable people. And you've got your universal credits, exactly the same. Disability money is exactly the same. It doesn't matter where you go. The people who will suffer more in this country are the most vulnerable. And I don't know how, but we have got to, somehow we've got to stop it. But for children's services, we are really, really, really being squeezed with children's services. But we are determined here as a council to do our very best to look after and protect the most vulnerable children in our society. Because as I said before, we're corporate parents, all of us. These children are our children and we have to look after them. I could go on about this forever, but it's really, really, really simple. We need more money. We need more money. And the only people who can provide that are the government, and they should be ashamed of themselves. They should be ashamed of what they're doing to children and to vulnerable people in this country. Lord Porter, for those of you who don't know, is a Conservative. So this is cross-party. These feelings are felt cross all sorts of divides. And some of the councils that are suffering are Tory councils. So it's not just a Labour problem. It's a problem for right the way across the board. So all we can do is carry on doing the very best for our children that we can.
Okay, thanks, Bernie. And I think that's the fact that you've got Lord Porter, who is the Tory chair of the LGA, saying this, I think speaks volumes, really. And let's just hope, you know, the government have got an ideal opportunity next week in the national budget to address this issue, and let's hope they do. So, you know, we'll obviously watch that announcement with great interest. Just a couple of other points I wanted to just make in support of what Janette said. I mean, I'm really glad that you gave the facts about the balances and reserves, because there is a lot of urban myths going around that this is the Eric Pickles line, that local authorities are sitting on millions of pounds worth of reserves, which they're not using, which they just need to dip into to balance the budget. What utter hogwash.
Yes.
What utter hogwash. As you quite rightly outlined, the reserves are earmarked, the majority of them. For some of the reserves, like school balances, it's illegal for the council to use them. We can't do. So the idea that there's a ready supply of money, and the idea that we should blow all our contingencies, which after all, you know, if we haven't had had that money for dealing with the new ferry, would have been nothing. The government hadn't given us anything. If we had not done it, wouldn't have been anything. So the idea that you blow all your contingencies and all your reserves on filling holes in the budget, it's just clapping that. And I'm really glad that you've debunked all those myths. So well done, Janette. And I think finally, I think the point that I want to make is, yeah, this council is under huge pressure, but I know that there is a huge, huge determination and commitment from both the administration and our officers to make sure that we will continue to deliver good quality frontline services, notwithstanding the horrendous cuts. And that will mean we've got to be more creative and innovative the way we deliver services, hence the debate we're having about leisure services and culture, and the debate we're having about having adult social care merged with the NHS. That's something that we've got to do because of the huge pressure that we're under. So thank you for making all of those comments. So just turning to the recommendation on page 305, page 306, the recommendations. Can we agree those recommendations?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. Okay, that takes us then on to the capital monitoring report for quarter two. Janette, to you again, please.
Okay, thanks, Phil. Headline in our capital monitoring report for quarter two is that we're keeping the council program under regular review to make sure it's being delivered as in line with planned timescales. This reduces the need to find funding, which in turn helps support revenue. Council program team we profiled to 68 million, with our spend to date of 14 million. Many projects progressing during the year as detailed in the report. Some of the key changes to our capital programme include both rural waters and schools programme, which have been reprofiled due to a change in the timetables. We're asking for five new proposals to the programme. They include cyber security, our cyber security programme, which is a European directive helping us keep us safe. However, it will be implemented across the country. Street lighting, which I'm sure Stuart would like to come in and speak about and finish, and a very exciting project called the Oregon Project. Phil, I'm sure you'd like to say a few words on that. Okay, so this is actually, I'm just asking the cabinet members to agree the recommendations on page 317 for this report.
Okay, thanks, Janette. So I bring Stuart in. Stuart on street lighting, an issue that obviously is of great interest to lots of members and members of the public.
Thanks, Phil, and I really welcome this extra investment in our streetlighting network. This is on top of the 7,500 new upgrades for LEDs, and also on top of the 500,000 pound that was agreed last March. This is obviously, even with all that investment, my inbox, the street line continues to be a concern to both members and residents alike. And I'm confident that this £500,000 will build on top of the previous allocation. And our contract is already on the ground now for replacing some of our expired stock. This will allow us to do more. And I'm really welcome to the
Yeah, okay, I think that is welcome additional investment in a really important service, street lighting. I think that's really good news. And I just wanted to use this opportunity to highlight the Eureka project. I think this is will be a fantastic development if we can we can bring it to Wirral. I'm delighted that the Eureka, which, as I'm sure most people know, is the National Children's Museum. They've got their existing facility based in Halifax. They want to open their second national facility in Wirral at Seacombe, which I think is wonderful news. I think all the evidence shows that the Eureka facility, as well as being a wonderful education facility for children and young people in Burmese. Obviously, we're talking about the importance of making sure that we've got children and young people who are well educated and ready for the world of work. And I think this Eureka Museum will help us meet that pledge in 2020 plan. This is a contribution towards a big effort now which is being made to raise the money, which is around 11 million, to actually get the project over the line. But I think everybody I speak to in Merseyside, I know the Natural Mercy government is very keen on landing this project for Merseyside and for Wirral, is really enthusiastic about this. So I think it's good that the council are contributing to helping us lever in this additional money. And we're talking to other organisations like the Arts Council and others about them contributing to this. So I think from a, both an educational point of view, from a regeneration point of view, I think the projection is that this would bring about a quarter of a million visitors in per year to Merseyside and Seacombe. Obviously, that's going to be great for the for Seacombe and for the Wallasey area and for the whole of the Wirral really, in terms of regeneration and investment, and being right next to Seacombe Ferry. That's great for the bringing visitors over from Liverpool. So a really good project, and obviously still a lot of work to be done, but so far it all looks very, very positive, and I'm glad that the council is able to contribute towards the cost of landing that hugely important project. Okay, so just ask if there are no other questions. No, okay. Ask Cabinet to endorse the recommendations on page 317 as moved by Janette. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you very much. And that takes us to the final item this morning, item 11, which is the Treasury Management and Monitoring report, the mid-year report, pages 333 to 354. Janette.
Okay, thanks, Bill. This is a key area for the Council, with the management of the Council's cash flow and investments and borrowing needs having made some significant savings in recent years. These savings have helped to fund frontline services which otherwise would have been subject to further reductions. This work continued in 2017-18 with a £2 million in-year saving for managing the cash flow in order to avoid the need to borrow. We continually look for opportunities to better manage our borrowings. Further review has been undertaken on our debt policy. Subject to Council approval of this change, we will see savings of £4.1 million in 2017-18, with this figure reducing year on year. We exercise careful and prudential treasury management on Wirral, as we're mindful that it's taxpayers' money that we're using. And I'd just like to finish by saying that, Phil, I agree with you. I'm holding out some hope that the Chancellor will reverse this failed austerity programme that was pushed forward by George Osborne. So while I hold out some hope, I'm not holding my breath.
Okay, right. Okay, well, I just want to add my thanks to the Treasury Management team for, I mean, they continue to generate savings and help us balance the books year on year. So thank you to everybody in the Treasury Management team for another really, really positive report, and thank you for the work you've done, you do to help us balance the books and contribute to our financial challenge. So recommendations that Jeanette's outlined on page 334. Can we agree that, Cameras? Okay, thank you very much. I've not been advised of any other business, so that concludes the proceedings this morning. Can I thank everybody for their attendance and close meeting?